Quick true story. I was getting on to a plane, and it was like early in the morning. I had a few books I wasn't really that excited to read. So when I sat down and saw that the person next to me was our next presenter, I was like, yes, this is so perfect for me. I don't know how he felt about it. You know the people like who want to, you know, do work on the plane and not be, you know, be chatted up by their pastor. Sorry about that. But God knows that I like seeing Bill Henson around. So like that, I think that was like a little bit of an answer for prayer for me. Bill Henson is the founder and president of the group, of the organization called Lead Them Home. And it is a ministry whose tagline is loving LGBT plus people in the church. So he's given his seminar, Posture Shift, to thousands of church leaders across North America and beyond. And it's obviously a sensitive topic, and if your life is similar to mine, this involves dear friends of ours. This involves our faith. This involves society. This involves our community. And so we asked Bill to share a little bit about his wisdom to the cause and to the work that he's dedicated his life to. So would you please welcome Bill Henson?
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Grace Chapel. Thank you, Q. It's an honor to be here. It's spring 2016. 15-year-old Eric now accepts that he's gay. He's known that he's been attracted to the same gender since he was 12, but he's spent the last 3 years trying to pray the gay away, and it hasn't worked. Who's been walking with Eric? Who knows about his journey? Friends? No. Mom and dad? Absolutely not. His pastor? Never. Eric is afraid, and no one can know. 1933, in Germany, the Gestapo was making lists of homosexuals. Over the next 12 years, 100,000 primarily gay men will be arrested. 50,000 of them will be sentenced, and 5 to 15,000 will be put into death camps. In the death camps, they will be pink triangle will be placed on their clothing so that they can always be identified as a homosexual person, so that people will know the risk that that person represents. Their death rate in the concentration camps will be 1.5 to 2 times greater than the general prison population. They will be mocked, they'll be assaulted, and they'll be assigned the most grueling work. If you're gay in a concentration camp, the best option is to lay low, but you can't lay low when you're marked. Eric also could not hide. Through no fault of his own, since elementary school, he was viewed as different. Was it how he talked? Was it the way he walked? Was it his interests and hobbies? His male peers set in motion a social habit of excluding him, teasing him, and bullying him all throughout his elementary and middle school years. If you're Eric, the best way to stay safe is to lay low. But you can't hide if you're being bullied every day. It's almost like Eric's peers had marked him with a pink triangle. His only hope was that his mom and dad would not know why the boys pick on him. 1973, Lafayette, Louisiana. 19-year-old David is a hippie kid, one of the rare brave souls in the early 70s to come out to his family. Like Eric, David grew up harassed and bullied. He took all that pain and very bravely, he turned it into something of personal value. He said, if people are going to hate me just for existing, I'm going to be the best gay person I can possibly be. His parents kicked him. When his parents found out about his sexuality, he had not even had sex, but immediately he was deemed to be a sexual deviant and they disowned him. They kicked him out of the home and they told him not to come back. He was soon homeless, and like many youth do today when they're homeless, he was forced to trade his body for shelter and food. In 2017, all these years later, family rejection continues to play a major role in LGBT youth homelessness. 5 to 7% of 10 to 25-year-olds identify as LGBT, yet they make up 20 to 40% of all homeless youth. Nearly 40% of them are forced to engage in survival sex, trading their bodies in order to access shelter and food. Back to Eric's story. Like many gay kids, he wonders, ooh, I know my parents love me, but what will happen when they find out? He could not imagine telling his parents, but sadly, they're about to find out. It could have been the boys at public school, the ones that bullied him for years. Instead, it was several boys in his church youth group that decided it would be funny to create a fake Instagram account with his name and his picture and start posting a bunch of gay pornography to the site. Overnight, Eric was outed throughout his entire church, his school, and partially the wider community. Some Christians even thought Eric purposely created the account in order to proudly announce his sexuality. 1983, Houston, Texas. Tens of thousands of gay men are battling a new disease that initially is called the gay plague. Over the next decade, AIDS will claim the lives of 250,000 people, gay and straight, male and female. After being disowned, David had moved to Houston, and now he was an early victim. Upon being hospitalized, his health rapidly deteriorated. He was quickly moved into hospice care, and as death approached, he was a pile of bones, and he became like a little boy, day and night, calling out, "Mommy, Mommy." The hospice nurse grew deeply attached to David. She fell in love with him as a son. She kept calling his parents because death was coming soon. She called his parents over and over and over again, and no one would answer the phone. Finally, one day, she got his father on the phone, and she said, "Sir, your son is very near death, and he's calling out for his mom and his dad. There's not much time. Please come and see him so he can let go." There was a long pause, and then his father said, "We don't have a son." And so this nurse hung up the phone and started weeping, knowing that David was dying, but that he couldn't let go. She went and she sat by his bedside. By now, she knew that he was blind and he was going deaf. And so she sat by his bedside and she stroked his hair and kissed his forehead and held his hand and said, "Son, it's okay, Mama's here. I love you." And with that, David had a gentle smile come across his face, and he took his final breath and gave up life. I know you're wondering about Eric because he's been through a lot. Despite all the bullying, he still has breath, and I praise God for that. LGBT teens like him who have been through bullying like he's been through are 2 to 4 times more likely to attempt suicide than their heterosexual peers. If you stack family rejection on top of bullying, then LGBT youth are up to 8 times more likely to attempt suicide than their heterosexual peers. David's parents stacked disownment on top of bullying, and it produced homelessness. Eric's parents were very sad to hear about his sexuality. They cried, but they cried holding him, and they continued to deeply love him and walk with him. A loving response from parents can mean the difference between home and homelessness, or life and death. June 12th, 2016, a gunman is on the loose inside Pulse nightclub. When it's over, 49 mostly LGBT people are killed and 53 others injured. Some Christian voices were heard saying things like, "We only wish there were more homosexuals that would have been in that club, so more of them could have been killed." When our ministry proposed a 1-year Pulse Memorial mission trip, we invited folks from around the country to join us. Many declined that invitation, saying, "I'm afraid that my presence at the Pulse site might condone the gay lifestyle." Thankfully, 20 people joined us from 9 states, including 2 gay students from the Northeast. And we had those gay students and gay teenagers that came alongside us at the site that we've never met, that we all came together and we had those LGBT students help us arrange the 1,000 memorial candles that we brought as a gift to grieve with those that are grieving. It was a beautiful moment. Think about this. Eric has been bullied at school. He's been outed by his youth group. And after the Pulse nightclub shooting, he can only conclude, "I could even get shot just for being gay." He told me this. He said, "I keep going to church because I love Jesus. And I keep going to church because I love my parents, but I'll never be part of a youth group ever, ever again. And this is the beginning of the deconstruction of a faith identity, and it's caused by trauma. As Christians, we've missed all this trauma. We're more shocked that beliefs are changing on marriage and sexuality. People are asking all the time, why are beliefs shifting so rapidly? If you allow mistreatment of a marginalized people to continue for decades, eventually a new generation will rise up and call it injustice. And if they have to change their beliefs to care for people well, they'll do it. Well, how are we going to bridge this divide? Well, there's three simple steps, and then afterwards, I'd be happy to talk with you more. Step one, stop the harm, because Jesus will have nothing to do with bullying or mocking or teasing or excluding LGBT people. Step two, increase family acceptance, because in family, there is no us and them. There's only us, and our LGBT loved ones are part of us. And finally, step three, enhance church inclusion, because a gospel that excludes has no power to reach already banished persons. Thank you. So,